Hi everyone and welcome to this very special episode of All About HR. My name is Nelly.
And I'm Dieter, and it's really great to welcome you as we look back at our first season and what were some of the trends that our guests have shared with us.
Welcome to another episode of All About HR. Yeah, so hi Dieter, how are you?
I'm doing very well, Nelly, yourself?
I'm very well too, and I'm super, super excited for today's episode. So for everybody who's watching, what we will be doing, we have identified some key topics that kept coming back during season one. And so today, Dieter and I are going to take a look at some of the things that our guests said during season one, and we're going to share our thoughts on those things. Now, I think we can get started probably with the first topic that we identified, Dieter, and that's all about data, surprisingly. And I think we're also going to talk about beachwear, actually.
I don't know whether I've got an opinion on that one, but let's talk about data.
It is important to really stress that we are data informed and not data driven. And I usually use the metaphor of a bikini. You know, it shows off a lot, but it hides the most important part. And I think data is the same thing. If you let yourself be driven only by data, it could actually lead you down in a rabbit hole. It can make you take wrong decisions because it gave you so much to go on.
I do believe that, especially for us, those who have been here for a while and have a lot of experience, we know in our gut where the data is telling us. So combining the two is critically important. I can tell you that I've made decisions based on data in the past and was wrong, and was really rarely wrong when I followed my gut. So I would definitely encourage leaders across the board, if something tells you that something is off, it usually is.
Yeah, so Dieter, I think great first snippet to start with. We listened there to Katharina Berg and to Anna Buber, and they were all talking about data. Mm. And there was the bikini part as well. I love that metaphor that Katharina uses to talk about data. I think the first thing here that is interesting to me is that we hit a distinction between data-informed and data-driven. Mm. I think that a lot of the time we are talking about being data driven. This is actually the first time that I hear people making this distinction. What are your thoughts on this? What are you thinking when you hear them talking about, no, we're data informed and not data driven?
Mm. Nelly, I think it's a very good kind of reflection to take on what is the difference between data driven and data informed. And listening to the clips, the first thing that comes to mind is I don't think we should get into a mode where we blindly follow data. I think there is this component to say, and you know, in some scientific research we talk about triangulation. So are there different things that is telling me or pointing me in the same direction? And I definitely think about being data informed is about saying what the data is telling me, what my experience is also telling me, and what my intuition is telling, and are all these things actually pointing in the same direction? And I think that's rather important.
Yeah, I think that's very true. Another question though that pops up here is then that we've often seen that the whole listening to your gut is kind of being dismissed and is being presented as something that is how not to go about things. And yet we do hear people talk about this gut feeling and experience. How can you find the right balance here or the right mix? Because maybe it's
I think there's a point there around that I think you shouldn't work on assumptions. But I again want to make the point around, I don't think you should also just blindly follow because the data tells you to. I think the data is one source of information that you do need to consider. I think as HR professionals, what we sometimes underestimate is that you are also a source of very good information and data. And how do you look towards what you've seen before, what others are telling you, and what the data is telling you, and combine those things into insights? I'm not a huge fan of blindly following intuition. I think there are some risks associated with that, but I wouldn't dismiss it completely. I think then you're not necessarily looking at all the available information.
Could I say then that it's about not blindly doing either one or the other? It's about not blinding following the data, but it's also not about blindly following your gut. Mm. So in that sense, maybe it's about using common sense?
And I think that's where the sweet spot is, right? I think the sweet spot is really around a little bit of common sense, using the data, using some of your past experiences, and then also looking at context, because I think that is also important, because data sometimes does not incorporate context, and something that might point in one direction in one context needs to be understood differently in another. And try and see the whole picture. And I think that's also what some of our guests try to tell us. Don't blindly follow, but try and see the whole picture and use that to be able to make your decisions.
Fantastic. I have nothing to add to that, Dieter. And I think, so we started out with the data part. Now, this kind of naturally brings us to another key topic that we identified all throughout season one, and that's all about business transformation and what's more, HR owning business transformation. So before I'm going to pick Dieter's brain on that, we are going to look at another clip.
When you want to look at digital HR transformation, you have to look at key capabilities within HR and look at how you build that capability for today and for the future. So having that capability view is very important. For example, let's take talent acquisition. We can think about talent acquisition as we bring ATS and implement it and we are done. Or we can think about talent acquisition as a capability and say it has CRM, it has the whole chatbot, it has intelligence piece, it has inner mobility. And how can we build pieces bit by bit? And what can we scale up for future and disrupt?
I do see that HR at least is becoming more open and they know that they can, you know, really influence their business and add a lot of value. But before they do that, they will have to brush up their own skills and learn the new ways of working.
Yes. So there we heard Manisha Singh and Khurshid Anis talk about HR owning business transformation. Mm-hmm. Now, Dieter, without wanting to play the devil's advocate here, I can imagine people listening to this or people watching this video and maybe getting a bit of HR transformation fatigue. Mm. So maybe we can start with, why are we still talking about HR transformation or HR owning business transformation? Why is this still so important?
I think you're absolutely right, Neely. I think a lot of people, when they hear the word transformation, they say, again, are we not always changing? At some point, surely we need to be able to get there from an end destination point of view. I think there's a few things yet why we are still talking about the topic. I think the last 2 years, I think, has fast-tracked a lot of things around the fourth industrial revolution. I think it's also fast-tracked and shaped the role that HR needs to play to be ready for this future of work. And I think that is why the topic is again relevant for us to discuss. On the other hand, though, I do think, and I really loved what they shared, is this realization, and it's one of the trends that we also identified at AIHR, as like looking at HR as a product and not as something that you are done and then you move on. And in that type of mindset, I think transformation becomes relevant because you are continuously innovating. You're getting feedback from the environment and then saying, but how does that look different? My last point there, why I think transformation is still relevant, is HR has finally crossed traditional organizational boundaries. We no longer ask the question around in which function does this sit. We rather ask the question to say, are we collectively and collaboratively providing the right solution? And we see HR teams being constituted differently in that particular way. And I think it is a different angle on transformation. I also think it's less about technology and a lot more about mindset and culture, which is why it's relevant right now.
Dieter, I think that is a very nice transition as well to the third key topic that we saw all throughout the first season of All About HR, and that's all about skills for HR professionals. So before we talk about that, let's go and take a look at the next snippet.
A couple of skills that we need to sharpen is the whole continuous listening and insight. So that's one. Second is the whole design thinking. Lots of time in HR, we've been guilty of designing policies and processes, keeping the one person people in mind who might break the rule, or take it to advantage. So how do we reverse that and design things keeping employees in mind? And that will help us break the silos. And lastly, the old art in HR, which was prevalent, is about the whole, how do you scale up the change? So I think we need to bring back that art of change management. Because let's say you design a new practice, but how do you scale it up? How do you ensure that employees and managers are adopting it and leaders are really living that?
So I think those are the three important things that we are increasingly discussing.
I think executive branding and presence and the ability to influence up and down the organization is a vital component to modern chief people officers. And often something that they get zero training in. And for some people who are lucky, like they have innate abilities in that area, and you know they're able to do that. For many, they don't, and they need that to be successful. And I would even say, and this kind of connects to that a little bit, is writing and communication. Written communication. I think so much of our, whether it's, you know, emails, blog posts, company memos, etc. Most of us in HR have never been trained in writing. And actually kind of, you know, articulating our thoughts and ideas in a concise way with written language. And so I think that's another piece that is really important. But I do agree that T-shape is important. You have to have a deep enough understanding in a lot of those areas, and you're probably only going to go deep in a couple of them.
Wow, Dieter, we hit a lot of different skills that people feel HR professionals need to equip themselves with. Perhaps to give our listeners and our viewers an idea of what we are talking about, it's good to start with the T-shaped mentioned by Lars. So tell us a little bit more about T-shaped and the kind of skills that we are linking to that T.
You know, I think there's a realization in the HR domain that there are certain things that we believe all HR professionals need to have, which really sits at the top of the T, as well then, as Lars has mentioned, then an in-depth knowledge of particular skill sets or of particular domains or technical areas. And what we think about when we talk about T-shaped, and I think, you know, some of our speakers also refer to that, is it goes beyond just firstly traditional business acumen, right? There is that, and a CEO once told me, which is something I've never forgotten, said, you need to understand my business to have a seat at the table, but never forget why and what voice you represent. And I think that's a beautiful thing to think about, that business acumen talks about understanding the external environment, understanding what is happening, but also realizing and knowing that how the business makes money. What is the commercial reality that the business is currently facing? It's my favorite interview question and I'm now sharing a trade secret here. In any interview, I always ask the HR professional, how do we make money as a business? And that's one of the best ways to see whether somebody really understands your context. They also refer to the skill next year that we talk about in terms of data literacy, you know, the ability to work and understand and translate data. And I think beautifully also summed up there was that as HR professionals, we are storytellers, and we need to be able to connect data with meaningful insights, with stories that matter in the context to whoever you are speaking to, whether that's the C-suite or whether you are speaking to the employee on the front line. They need to understand, what does this mean for them and why does this matter to them? And I think that's a critical skill that we look at in as part of the T-shape. The third component there is around digital integration. And, you know, we've just spoken about the importance of business transformation. And I think if you think that digital is about technology, you really need to rethink that, because digital is about culture. And it's about the ability for the HR professional to understand, how do I use digital and how do I drive the adoption of digital? You know, the concept of change navigation and change adoption, I think that is so, so important as a core and as a critical skill. And then lastly, to refer back to my first point around, you have to be a people advocate. And it refers back to the point to say, even in business acumen, I've got a seat at the table, but I am the people voice. And you have to make sure that you understand what that means. You have to be the individual that speaks up for the voice, that drives inclusivity in the environment as well. And lastly, I think, and this is something that really excites me, is HR's role beyond organizational borders. What is the impact that you are making around HR, or leveraging HR for good and using that to the benefit of society? Because we have to have a voice in conversation about societal issues as well. And those things lie at the top of the T-shaped. And that's a very high bar, but I think that is the expectation for an HR professional to be very relevant in the future world.
That is a very high bar, Dieter. But I mean, it's good to have a challenge, I think, as well. And I think what's the beauty of this is that it makes for the role of HR professional, it makes it a very varied role. It's not just about the data. It's not just about change and how you drive change. It's not just about stakeholder management, but there's all these different aspects to touch on. And I think that's probably what makes it for a super fascinating job to do, right?
I mean, what a great time to be in HR, right? I think if there was ever an opportunity to make a meaningful difference and have an impact, it is now. Because I think, you know, one of the positive things and that we can take out of what has happened over the last 2 years is that we do have the opportunity to reshape and rethink quite a number of things in the organizational environment. Mm-hmm. And who better to lead that conversation than HR?
Yeah, I love that. It's a blank canvas and it's up to us really to decide how we're going to paint this canvas.
No, definitely. Very exciting times.
Yeah, I love it. All right, so we looked now specifically at HR. But we are going to broaden the scope a little bit while we are going to take a look at this next topic that we saw all throughout season one. And it's about talent, hiring candidates, and by extension, talent marketplaces. So let's start again with a look at the snippets.
The key principle of our progression framework is that the only path for promotion isn't management. So there's different tracks you could be on. So you can either be on a technical track, which is a very common thing for engineering. So you could be a manager or a technical. But we've also added a third track for those who are more entrepreneurial or kind of product mindset. But that basically it opens up more options for people to rely on their strengths to be promoted, and also really helps us explain that the diversity of your background and your strengths is actually a huge benefit to us. We don't just need 117 managers. We actually need people with different perspectives and different strengths to work together.
If companies and HR won't do it, the employees will. We're already seeing employees reach out to say, let me see what other opportunities are available to me, whether it's in my company or not. In fact, our work from home study this year found that 1 in 5 employees have taken on a new gig outside of their full-time job to gain new skills and experiment with other job opportunities. That's a significant number. So again, this is an area where HR can get ahead of this by being the one that enables employees to understand what their career path is, to think about what the key skills that they are need to get there, but also to understand what opportunities are available so that they see a growth path within their own company.
Yes, Dita. So the first thing that I'm very excited about here is that we really see that more and more, there's not just one path for employees. Mm. It's not just the only way is up, meaning a vertical progression, but there's also more and more so this possibility to progress, but like horizontally. And I think this is very exciting because as Jessica said, she said, we don't need 170 managers, but also not every employee wants to become a manager, but they still want to progress and they still want to grow. And that's, I think, what we saw here, what Rebecca was talking about. If the company is not offering this opportunity to them, then they're going to look for it themselves elsewhere. So that's what I'm very excited about, to see this kind of development. But what are your thoughts on this?
I have to agree with you, Neely. I love the thinking that is moving into the career domain at the moment. And I think firstly, you know, we're moving away from the traditional career path that says a career is defined by a number of roles in a particular sequence. And I think, you know, human beings have never really worked in that way. So I think it's fantastic to think that we are now starting to explore careers more as a collection of experiences over time. Now, whether that is associated with roles, whether that's associated with levels, I think it provides the opportunity to think very differently about progression. I love the thinking also around that we are no longer just differentiating, you know, either I want to manage people or I like the specialist technical type of work. That there's other opportunities for people also to apply some of their strengths and some of their passions as part of that. You know, in the old world, we used to have this saying that if you're really good at your job, I take you out of it and I make you watch other people do it. So I make you a manager. And if you're really great at that, then I promote you one more level and then you start thinking about strategy. So you're thinking about the work that you used to do that others are now doing on your behalf. And I don't think organizations work that way. And I don't think you get the best out of people either. And the last point there is, I definitely think if we don't come to the table as HR, employees will do it for us. And we're already starting to see that the trend at the moment around overemployment or the overemployed, where people take on a second and even a third job. I think that has become very, very relevant. We do need to think about the changing notion of the employer and the employee relationship and contract. And what does employment really, really mean? I think traditional employment, even though it still has a place, you know, the 8 to 5, 40 hours a week, but I don't think that's the only way to have a relationship with an employee. And I think we need to think a little bit broader with regards to that. And it's going to take a big mindset shift for the organization, for leaders, for managers, and HR needs to help with that in order to make this new talent marketplace viable and feasible going forward.
Yeah, first word that comes to mind when I hear you talk about this thing, Dieter, thinking about what does employment really mean, I think here it's very important that we go to this holistic perspective again. Because, and it has been so for quite a few years already now, the traditional form of full-time employment is not the only thing that exists. And because of reasons such as the difficulty to find talent, organizations have for quite a while already been working with the people who are having a fixed contract, but and freelancers and contractors and you name it. So it is already a mix within the organization of people with various, let's say, types of employment relationships with the organization. So I think there we need to go to a holistic approach, to be honest. Now, I do want to make the step briefly here to specifically this talent marketplace phenomenon, I'm going to call it, that we see now. So maybe we can talk about what we mean by talent marketplace and also, yeah, let's start with that.
Yeah, it's a very good question. You know, and I think, Neely, we've spoken about gig work a lot over the last couple of years, you know, contractors, permanent employees. And I think, firstly, we need to change our language, because I think words have got meaning around what we associate that with. So let me make it practical. In a lot of organizations, still being permanently employed then means that I form part of benefit programs. I form part of certain privileges in the organization. And there has to be a shift to say that regardless of your relationship with me, there's certain things that I also think about. You know, a lot of our organizations where the gig workers and the contractors actually outnumber the permanent employees. What does that do to organizational culture, for example? Because the people that you have that you want to connect and commit to you as an employer are not your permanent employees only. And that stretches a little bit further. So I think when we start talking about talent marketplaces, it is about redefining what that landscape looks like and redefining the relationships that we have with various stakeholders, role players, talent, whatever you want to call it, as part of pulling them together and aligning them around a common goal. And that's really what an organization is, right? It's getting people together with different skill sets and aligning them towards the same direction to achieve a common goal. And I think there it has to go deeper than a contract. It has to almost start talking about, you know, and we often talk about the psychosocial contract. It's that thing that you expect from me and the thing that I give to you, and maybe we articulate it and maybe we don't. And I think there has to be some work that we do around how are we going to manage these multifaceted relationships in this talent marketplace? And on the other side, from an individual employee point of view, how do we open up opportunities for them? Because, you know, maybe the secondary career that you want to have, not only it might be beneficial for me, but maybe it will keep you with me for a little bit longer. And maybe I can leverage that skill as well. And I need to be open to that.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you made a really good point there, by the way, Dieter, about basically what you were saying, if I'm correct, is that words matter. Because if we say someone is a gig worker, this automatically has this sort of connotation of somebody not being part about maybe the workforce of it, because it's like a gig worker or it's a contractor or a freelancer. So they're not part of the organization. And I think there's definitely a lot of work to be done there to think about this differently and to, as you said, name it differently as well. Because at the end of the day, everybody should at least be behind the same mission at the company.
No, I wanted to completely agree with you there. You know, I think there's some horrible examples, and I've seen that before. You know, company breakaways where everybody's in the same office, but, you know, at 3 o'clock, all the permanent employees leave because the company breakaway is planned for that evening, right? And the gig workers and the contract workers remain behind. And I think we have to change the culture, you have to change the language. And once you've changed the language, you also have to make sure that you put the practices behind it. And, you know, you raised the point, and I think it's been such a topical issue this year around belonging and why do I belong and do I feel like I belong? And surely belonging does not sit with a legal contract between the two of us around my working hours. Surely it goes much deeper than that. And I think that's the opportunity.
Nothing to add again, Dieter. So now we are going to the next topic that we identified, and it's about rewards and benefits. Let's take a look again.
And it's really about inclusivity again. You see, I'm a great believer in diversity, and in my view, everybody's different. And so to have the kind of reward system that tells you what's good for you and gives you what's available but no choice seems to me to be misguided. And so with sufficiently advanced technology, we should be able to manage a much, much more varied approach to reward, where we basically sort of say the company is prepared to pay you a certain amount. How you decide to take that is up to you. May not change the total cost to the company, but the provision of that can be something that really suits your lifestyle or your life cycle. So I would say that that's probably, you know, my prediction would be that's the single most important aspect that we all need to work on in reward, is making more engagement, making it a two-way street where you can interact with your reward rather than simply receive it.
You need to have a very good understanding of who are you trying to attract and can you attract them. So I think of compensation and benefits similar to how you think about pricing if you were in a marketing or revenue team. You need to understand, like, how knowledgeable and experienced do we need our team to be? How much leverage are they going to have? What kind of geography do we need them to be in? How committed are we to a remote or distributed approach? Think about what you're actually trying to achieve. And then if someone in your team says, well, I'm leaving because I could have got more money if I went and worked for a San Francisco company, then you shouldn't be basing your entire company's compensation off that one person. You really should be okay with losing that person, because probably that's not the kind of person that you want to be attracting to your subscription product long term.
A lot of information here and a lot of things happening in the rewards and benefits area, Dieter. So I'm not going to say anything for now because I really want to hear from you first. What stood out for you in this snippet?
I think, Neely, the first thing definitely was the movement away from a paternalistic reward approach, which just means, I think, a lot more flexibility and choice being introduced into the reward and compensation domain. I think it also comes, however, on the other side of the coin with the responsibility still from an organizational point of view to educate people about the decisions that they make. So, for example, if I just give you a summary total cost to company and you can choose, you know, pension benefits, medical benefits, or whether I take the cash every single month. I think you need to understand what you are doing from an employee perspective, and the employer has to help that people make informed decisions. Otherwise, we will end up not with a problem now, but with a problem in a couple of years' time when people realize, oh, but hang on, I did not necessarily save for the longer term. I do think, though, and something else that stood out, which I really love in the benefits domain, is the personalization component, right? Which is around, do I really understand my employee as a consumer? Because employees are also consumers and reward is a product. Mm-hmm. And do I really know and understand what their wants and needs and desires are? And does it then make sense around what I offer? In that space, though, you have to be very clear around what you can and what you can't offer. And I think that's been something that, you know, and I think as recruiters, sometimes we sell something or we sell an experience that we can't deliver on. And I think that is going to and have to change around the fact to say that, you know, maybe we don't offer all the 25 benefits that other organizations offer, but there's reasons for that. And it's aligned to who we want to attract and who we want to keep and who we want to be as an organization. My last point, which I think is super relevant and very exciting, is, you know, to also start thinking about benefits and rewards in the domain of what's happening in the world around us. You know, what is really happening and how have things changed? And I think there's a lot of great organizations doing things for their employees around, you know, benefits associated with gender-based violence, for example, benefits associated with miscarriages, benefits associated with well-being in the sense of looking at the entire family structure. And I think that's definitely the direction to go in, because I think it makes you human. I think it makes you real and makes you relevant as an organization in terms of seeing your employees in the context within which they find themselves.
And from there, we are going to another topic, and this is DEIB. Let's watch.
But I think the biggest change I've seen is that employees want purpose-driven work. They want to make an impact, they want to matter, and they want companies to invest in them. Just as employees are investing their, you know, 40-hour days, 40-hour weeks, sometimes maybe even 50, 60 right now in terms of where we're, in terms of the pandemic that we're living in. But I think people want to matter and they want to work at companies that invest in their learning and development. And so those are really some of the questions that we get asked right now, right? Like in terms of employees, what is it that we're doing for them? How do we contribute to their growth and their careers? Those are all things that people want to understand before they actually join company.
When you start to look at inclusion and belonging and the way everyone in the company can prosper and thrive, And you start to look at how do you pay all different kinds of people at every level? What is the mix of people that you have at every different leadership level? Are all of the voices in the room equally heard and equally celebrated? And can every single person contribute their own unique gift in a way that feels safe? Then you know that you have inclusion and you have belonging. And that actually leads to real diversity that's sustainable and that makes a difference in your company's performance.
We touched on it a few times already during our conversation today, but I think the big, big one here is belonging, right? Mm-hmm. So let's start with belonging. When it comes to belonging though, Dieter, mm-hmm. I have this feeling that it's a term that everybody is using right now. Mm-hmm. Because they have this idea that, yeah, we need to do something around belonging. But there's a very big difference, I think, between talking about belonging and actually putting this into practice. What's your take on that?
Mm. I think you're right, Neely. I think we need to be careful around using belonging as a blanket term for a whole bunch of other things in the organization. I think there is a stance that we do need to take. And for me, belonging is and links very closely to culture. It leans itself very, very closely towards saying, are we truly an organization where people from different walks of life have the same opportunity to be able to achieve their potential? And I think that's what belonging should be about. It is about creating trusted and safe environments. And, you know, I think there's a lot of good work being done in the diversity and the inclusion space around that. But I think belonging has to be around what type of organization what type of organizational culture do we foster? And how is that going to make sure that people feel welcome and that people feel that they can find a space there? The risk we run is, I think we shouldn't go with vanilla solutions. I think belonging looks a little bit different for everybody. And what I loved about the clips is it also comes down to, what do I want from work? How do I find meaning in work? And, you know, what workplace is going to be suitable for me to be able to live that out and align my goals as well.
Yeah, and I think, and then to basically just come back for a second to the rewards and benefits part that we just talked about, I think once you've truly found that belonging, that sense of belonging in the organization you're working for, it doesn't matter as much that the organization is not necessarily offering these 25 benefits that other companies do, right? Because the most important thing comes from the fact that you have found fulfillment in the job that you're doing.
Agree. You know, I always think about, you know, sometimes in the employee value proposition space, I've asked people, you know, but what are your non-negotiables? Because all of us have them. You know, there's a few non-negotiables for me that would make me say no to any employer immediately. And if you are clear on what those are, then I think it becomes a very different conversation. You know, then it is not about the 25 benefits. It becomes around, is there alignment between what I find important in life and what this organization can offer?
Absolutely. On that note, we are going to go to the next clip, and I'm not going to say anything more about it.
An interesting concept is, how do you actually get trust? How do you build trust? So it's one thing to say, how do you measure it? But how do you build it? What's the inputs to trust? One thing that we talk about in our leadership training is, start with empathy to build trust, right? So I talked about the beginning, like what's the brightening experience? It's about being in a compassionate culture wrapped around an important mission. And so empathy and compassion is different than being nice, right? It's different than being kind, or ruinous empathy is a concept that Kim Scott talks about. But a compassionate culture is one that also probably has vulnerability, right? So if your leadership team is routinely vulnerable, and they talk about what their own hopes and fears are, what, you know, like struggles that they're dealing with in their life, and sort of shows you what it means to be a human, your leader is humanizing the workplace and is showing up as a human, then I'm gonna start to trust you a little bit more. Because, okay, you're a human, you're a good person. And I'm gonna trust you a little bit more. And then therefore, I'm gonna give you a little bit more of me, of myself. And so vulnerability in that sense, at least for us, is an important input to getting to trust.
This clip is about, among other things, mental health. For me, I think there are two interesting routes to take here when we talk about mental health. So on the one hand, there is mental health for the people within the organization. Very, very important. We are going to talk about that. And I think on the other hand, and this is something that we may forget about, but this also, how are we doing as HR professionals? But let's start first with the mental health for the people working in the company. What are you seeing in this space?
I think we need to start to first acknowledge that mental health has been a conversation even before COVID. And I think a lot of people keep on tying the argument around mental health to, but COVID has now happened, so we need to talk about mental health and mental well-being. I think we need to move away from that and to be able to say, but what do we really want to achieve from a well-being point of view? And the first thing I see at the moment, which I'm very excited about, is that people are starting to talk about holistic well-being, because as a human being, there's different facets and components to you. It's not just mental well-being. It's not just physical well-being. It's not just emotional or psychological well-being. There's different components that we all need to look at. And, you know, I think definitely around seeing the whole human, and seeing the whole human with all the, you know, warts and all the needs and wants and desires that you need to have. The second one is that well-being is a dual responsibility. It's not just the organization's responsibility, and it's not just the individual's responsibility. But both parties need to come to the table with regards to that. You know, I've spoken to quite a few CHROs over the past couple of months, and they all share the same sentiment that, you know, they get so agitated when the organization has done everything to keep employees safe from a physical point of view during the week. And then, you know, if I go on your Instagram feed over the weekend, I see, you know, you're in an unprotected environment, not wearing a mask, not socially distancing. And yet that next week you complain to me as an employer that you're not doing well, you know, that you've contracted the virus. I think it is a dual responsibility that we do need to think about. And I think we need to think broader in a more holistic sense. And then lastly, I think we need to be absolutely practical, because I think well-being has very often been extremely abstract for people. And that is also why we still sit with issues around stigmatization in the organization pertaining to mental well-being. You don't think twice about phoning in sick when you are not feeling physically well. But what if you actually just need a bit of a break from a mental point of view? And I think that has to change, and we have to normalize that conversation. That will only happen through vulnerability and open conversations, and leaders also admitting that, you know what, hey, I'm also struggling.
Well, these were all three very good points. And I think firstly, the whole holistically or having a holistic view, that seems to be the magic theme all throughout our conversation today, Dieter. But I think the second thing that's very true and very important is that there's still the stigma around mental health. And it's so true, because you do phone immediately when you're feeling not well, when you have a sore throat, whatsoever, but you don't do it as easily when you're mentally just having a bit of an off day or maybe an off couple of days. Mm. Very true. Now, just let's go to the other side as well, Dieter, because you do talk to a lot of people who are HR professionals, CHROs. How is HR doing, without wanting to generalize?
I think nearly the first thing is, I think HR is fatigued. And I think HR is really, really tired in a few ways. I think the first one is, you know, you've been expected to have the answer, or if you didn't have the answer, at least to be the person that listens to what all the challenges are. And I think a lot of people have projected their uncertainties onto us as HR professionals. And it's been a really tough period, you know, over the past 2 years. So I think there is some almost dealing with trauma work that HR needs to do for themselves. Firstly, let's make sense of what has happened to us and where we find ourselves. Let's have a little bit of grace also around the fact that it's okay to be tired. You're not superhuman just because you carry the HR label. You are also a human being, and this has been tough for you as well. And then I think thirdly around is to say, but what are the things that we can start putting in place, and will be different for every single individual, to re-energize you? Because I think what we are starting to realize is that, you know, 2022 will still bring additional challenges. These things are not going away. We're going to have to find a way to deal with them in the normal flow of life. And to do that, you need to be able to build your own resilience from an HR point of view. But ask for help. Reach out. This is not a journey that you should walk alone.
Very true. And wise words. Dieter, I want to thank you so much for being here today and for talking with me about these season one highlights. Thank you very much.
Always great. And thank you so much for having me, Neely.
And I want to thank everybody for tuning in as well. I hope you enjoyed the episode as much as I did. If you haven't done so yet, please do not forget to subscribe to our channel, hit that notification bell, and like this episode. Thank you very much, and see you soon for another episode in a new season. Bye.